Now, I know you've all probably heard of the tragedy of the commons. I've put in place here the simple definition that comes out of Wikipedia, and it says, the tragedy of the commons is a dilemma arising from the situation in which multiple individuals acting independently and rationally consulting their own self-interest will ultimately deplete a shared limited resource, even when it is clear that it is not in anyone's long-term interest for this to happen. Okay, that's the general description of the tragedy of the commons. But I actually find that people don't really understand often exactly what that means. So I think this, I've got a good metaphor for what the tragedy of the commons is really all about. And here it is. So imagine you have two kids and you give them a smoothie, very cold, with two straws. What's going to happen? They're going to suck really fast, trying to race each other to get as much of that as they can, and get a brain freeze. So to me, this is a perfect example of the tragedy of the commons. Here you have a shared resource neither one of them owns. Their immediate reaction is, I want to get as much of that as I possibly can, so they suck as fast as they can, and instead of enjoying this resource, they do something that is not in their own self-interest and they get a brain freeze. So if you substitute fish for the smoothie, fishermen for the two children, and collapsed fishery for the brain freeze, this is, I think, an exact description of how a common pool resource like fish, where everybody owns it, but individuals have to race to try to get as large a fraction as they can, leads to a variety of outcomes that are not in anyone's best interests, but are totally rational from the standpoint of them, given the situation they've been put in, if we manage the fishery in this particular way. So the question is, are there solutions to this problem? And yes, there are many. I mean, in some ways, the marine protected area example I already gave you is one form. Essentially, what has happened in that case is someone has taken away a part of that smoothie so that no matter how fast the kids consume what is left, they can't get a brain freeze. They've basically taken insurance away, so no matter what kind of actions they take, they can't have the problem. The other way you can solve this problem is by having somebody from the outside impose rules on the two kids. So parents could say, and watch them very carefully, don't suck fast, because you'll get a brain freeze. But that's, I think, as everybody in the room who's a parent will know, will only be effective a small fraction of the time. So imposing regulations that tell them don't do things that are not in your long-term interest, even though you have incentives to do it in the short term, is not usually a viable answer to this problem. A third way is if the two kids cooperate, and if one of them, for example, has leadership capabilities that allows them to convince the other one that we are stupid to race each other, we should do this in a way that provides mutual benefit. And there are clearly examples of situations like this where cooperative behavior with leadership, Ellen Ostrom got the Nobel Prize basically for demonstrating this kind of a solution, where leadership among individuals and the formation of cooperative behavior among individuals can counter some of these kinds of incentives. But there are still limits in terms of how frequently that is going to be effective. So the last class of solution is something that's been put forth a long time by economists, which is basically says, divide the resource and provide some level of rights on the part of the two users, that if they each have their own share, they will drink this smoothie in a very, very different way. Okay? And so the argument here is that ownership, where you have clear ownership and property rights for the long term, is a mechanism of creating your incentive to take actions that have long-term benefits and not be drawn into these kinds of actions where they're short-term. From the standpoint of fisheries, there are many forms of rights like this that can be put into fisheries. And in some places in the United States, we call these catch shares. There really are kind of two classes of most commonly forms of rights. One is where the fishermen individually own a share of the total fishery. So this is analogous to being a stockholder in a business, where you own some fraction of the total catch, and you have security in knowing that you get that fraction each year. And the reason why this potentially creates long-term stewardship is because if you own 5% of the fishery, you benefit by having that 5% be of a larger total for the long term. So if you take actions that enhance the recovery of the fishery and enhance the stock to where it's at a more sustainable level, your 5% share of a larger value will be more fish. And if you take actions and have that security that you know you're going to benefit, it changes the nature of the kind of relationship that you would have. The other way you can put in rights is by spatial harvesting areas. So this is more analogous to the way we have allocated rights to resources on land. Another way where, just like dividing up that smoothie, you can divide up pieces of the ocean where actions on the part of individuals can be taken to benefit the stock in a particular place, and you as an individual are the one that then gets to see the long-term outcome of those actions. So, as I said, economists pitched this idea nearly 30 years ago, and in some places it was actually led to a transition in the way we manage fisheries. If we look at their success, again, in the same way we analyze the success of the experiments that have been done with marine protected areas, we can look at this from the standpoint of putting rights into fisheries. That here's the pattern of what we have seen over time in terms of the collapse of fisheries globally. For those species that have never converted to this kind of a catch share fishery. And starting in 1950, where there was roughly 0% of the global fisheries in a state of collapse, there's been a continual increase over time to where in the early 2000s, when this data set was pulled together, about 28% of global fisheries were in a state of collapse. If we then look, though, at the experiment that was done since in about 1970, a few countries, New Zealand, Iceland in particular, and since then a number of countries around the rest of the world have started to implement a few of these catch shares. It's now about 1% of the total global fisheries in terms of number of fisheries that have been doing. You see a very different pattern of what's happened. That rather than a trend of increasing collapse, these species have gone from having a very similar level of collapse at about 10% when this started, now to having a global pattern of about 4%. Now, these are all for fisheries that are of that first form of catch share, where individual fishermen own a share of the quota. That approach works well in large fisheries, but it requires a lot of information. It requires a fairly large investment on the part of government for management. But I think this evidence suggests that it can be extremely successful. The evidence for the other form is more recent, and there are a much smaller number of places that have actually tried the model of allocating spatial rights to individual fishermen or groups of fishermen. And the one I want to highlight, which I think is the best example and I think is a remarkable success, is what has been happening with spatial ownership in Chile. These spatial areas are called TERFs, which stands for Territorial User Rights Fisheries. And this approach in Chile was started in response to a complete collapse of one of their most important fisheries for a shellfish called loco. And the fishery was shut down for a number of years, and during this period of time, they implemented a rule of allowing fishermen to apply for exclusive fishing rights to particular areas. So there are some similarities to the examples that have been happening here in Costa Rica with sustainable fishing areas that we saw yesterday on a field trip. Really, really nice study. This goes a little bit beyond in the sense that these areas have exclusive rights to fish in those areas for a particular group of people. In the intervening 12 years since this started, there are now over 700 of these TERFs that have been set up along the Chilean coast, and about 40,000 fishermen are involved in this form of fishing. There's still a lot of other areas that are fished in the normal way. The response has really been dramatic. if